On today's show,
we debate which cellar dweller has a brighter future, the Lakers or the 76ers.
In the Up-Down Report, is it time to change all-star voting? And how long should Laser Pointer Man be banished?
And Ledlow joins us live from Cali to set up tonight's NBA TV doubleheader.
It's Tuesday, January 5th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or catching us on NBA TV and or YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Millis.
Hope your New Year's resolutions are going well, because mine aren't.
To his right, sorry to hear that, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele, and finally, last, certainly not least, it's Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Heyo!
Heyo!
TK, what do you got for us today?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters. Anything good will get mentioned, but also, Draymond Green had a triple-double again last night, guys, and only took him 8 shots to do so. Just the 64th time in NBA history a player has taken that few shots and still notched a triple-double. Cool stats.
Yeah.
I know, but the reason I bring it up is because the guy who scored the most points in that scenario is none other than my main man, Brad Miller.
Oh, man.
Shout out to Mike Kaplan, a producer here, for the tip. Way back in 2003, Brad's first triple-double went for 22, 14, and 10, and the Kings win. And usually I have a fun question to ask, but let's just bask in the glory of these highlights of that headband. Beautiful stuff. If you're watching at home, tweet at us, use hashtag the starters, and we'll hear from you later.
How many triple-doubles did he have?
I don't know, probably 50 or 60.
He's a legend.
One, at least.
Brad Miller,
he said first.
All right, great stuff. All right, look, we got the Up-Down Report on tonight's show, and as we said, Kristen Ledlow is going to join us live from Cali to get us ready for the Warriors-Lakers game, which you can see here on the network later tonight. But first, we're playing a little What You Got. It's been a little while. If you're new to the show, here's how this works. Trey presents us with two related topics. We have to determine the better choice. The catch, Trey knows the only right answer. So we have to get inside Trey's head, which means we're also inside his beard.
That's exactly right.
Trey, what do you got?
To clarify things, 3 triple-doubles in the career for Brad Miller.
Wow.
Great stuff. But
that's
anyways, against
check.
All odds, the Los Angeles Lakers are on a 3-game winning streak. Meanwhile, the 76ers have won 3 of 6 since they signed Ish Smith. So tell me, guys, who's going to have the better record at the end of the season? The Lakers or the Sixers?
This is
what
a question.
Yeah, this is hard. I'm going with those Sixers.
What?
Yep. They had 1 win through 31 games. Can
right.
you believe it?
They've
quadrupled their total in the last 6 games. Why? Because they got an NBA-worthy point guard in Ish Smith. And not to disrespect Kendall Marshall and TJ McConnell. I don't even know the names of those guys. I'm just kidding. But they may not be around next year. Yeah, Ish Smith has bounced around the league. But this is his 6th year, and he will be around the next couple of years. You pair him with an assistant coach like Mike D'Antoni, who works well with point guards. Now they have an actual team, an actual point guard. Ish Smith should have never left Philadelphia. He was there to end the year last year. He should have got a guaranteed contract. It makes no sense. I guess it does make sense if you want to lose games.
Mm-hmm.
But now pairing him, I'm saying that they are going to surpass the Los Angeles Lakers, even though they have half their wins right now.
I was
going
to say, Lakers at 8 wins and Sixers at 4.
We don't know how good this team could be. Playoffs? No. Absolutely not. But we don't know because we didn't have an NBA-capable point guard. And now they do.
I think they're in the honeymoon period a little bit, though. You know, they have won those 3 games. Great for them. Great for their organization because it was so awful. So up to this point.
Yeah.
But the Lakers have already won 8. Lakers had a really good win, too, in Boston. And since then, they've beaten the Sixers and the Suns as well. So the Lakers have got some sort of momentum going.
Yeah.
And I think they're more likely to win that sort of 15 to 20 games. I don't think the Sixers have got quite that in. I think they're going to be hovering closer to sort of 10 to 12 games myself. So I'm going with the Lakers. I like D'Angelo Russell. I think he's going to be very good. If he gets the right time and he gets the right coaching, I think he's going to be a very good player. Julius Randle, there's a lot of problems with this team. There's a lot of infighting with the coaching and things like that. But I just think as this Kobe swan song carries on, I think there's going to be a little bit more momentum, a little bit more energy. I think the Lakers are going to win a few more games.
I also go with the Lakers. Funny enough, you know, some of these wins have come without Kobe Bryant playing. Mm. And this is when Lou Williams has played some of his best basketball for the Lakers. We saw Lou carry the Raptors at times last year.
Mm-hmm.
He really hadn't done a whole lot up to this point. He's on a bit of a run, 54 total points in those last 2 games without Kobe. I like Larry Nance. I like the energy he brings in the starting lineup. I just think that difference, the 4-8, which doesn't sound like a whole lot, is a whole lot when it comes to these teams. I got to go with my man Lee and say the Lakers will have more wins.
I can understand what you're saying. 4 wins seems like a lot for the Sixers, and that gap of 4 seems like a lot because they didn't win a lot of games to start the year. But this is a whole new team. I know it's not a good team, but it's a whole new team considering, you know, they've got some older guys now coming in, and Elton Brand and Carl Landry, some NBA players, real players on this team. I mean, the roster is like overturned by 25%. It's a different team than the 1-30 team.
All right, well, what's the answer here? Is it the Lakers or Sixers? Who's going to have the
best
record?
Well, it's an impossible choice, but the right answer is the Sixers are going to have the best record because they haven't finished with the worst record in the NBA the past two seasons, even though you would think they did.
That's a good point.
Finishing third or second, really impressive stuff. But moving on, Brandon Jennings was instrumental in the Pistons' big win over the Magic last night. Some say it was a virtuoso performance, and they're now 2-2 since he returned from injury, but he's not the only point guard who's back, because Kyrie Irving has come back for the Cavs, and they've been a dominant 5-1 since his return. Who's had a more impactful return so far, Brandon Jennings or Kyrie Irving? Ooh. What you got?
That's a good question.
Kyrie Irving. Because last night we saw old Kyrie back, where he was spinning and twisting and turning and scoring. I mean, he had a great game scoring the ball, but it was more about how he looked on the court to me, that flow he had going. And more importantly, he allowed LeBron James to sit out that fourth quarter last night. Remember, it was this time last year when LeBron sat down for a couple of weeks. He's probably going to miss some time throughout the season as well.
Yeah.
And for the Cavs to have Kyrie back playing at this level, knowing that they can close out games and get those wins, that's very, very important for the Cavs long-term, especially in the playoffs.
I think if the word is impactful, I don't know how you don't go Kyrie, because he's going to impact whether the Cavs can legitimately win a title or not. Because especially with the way LeBron's struggling shooting the basketball right now, it's going to help a team like the Cavs to say, hey, Kyrie, if he is back to the way he looked against the Raptors last night, you know, go on your 10-0 runs by yourself, hit the threes, create for guys. I mean, he's just a scoring machine. But I think, to make a case for Jennings, I think it's a little more interesting return with Jennings coming back from his injury. We saw him play in the D-League there. He looked great in the D-League, had a quick little burn. But then this sort of breakout game last night, 17 points, 6 assists, you know, killing the Magic. And they were plus 18 when he's out there on the floor. It's more interesting because now the Pistons have a question. You know, they had no bench. We've already talked about that. They had no bench. So this really helps them. But do they think they can keep Brandon Jennings this summer when he becomes a free agent? How much does he get? We saw point guards like Reggie Jackson and Dragic and so on get paid a lot of money. Is he on that level? Maybe not. But they're going to have a decision here. Do you keep him, help your bench, try and make a playoff push because you haven't been in the playoffs in a long time? Or do you try and trade him now, get something back with the idea that you're going to lose him anyway? That's a tough question, I think, for Van Gundy and the Pistons.
I think Stan Van's going to play him a ton, and the Cavs are going to win no matter what they throw out there. So I think Brandon Jennings is a more impactful player because Stan Van does not trust his bench. He plays his bench the fewest minutes in the league. They score the fewest points in the league. So Brandon Jennings is going to get out there on a contract year and play his butt off and do well. He's going to play a lot of minutes for this team. Cavs are going to win, matter what.
We got two Jennings, one Kyrie. What's the answer?
A lot of good points, but the winner is Kyrie Irving. Clearly the most impactful because he changes the NBA playoff picture, the championship picture. Pretty impactful stuff. And moving on to our final topic, senior citizens, although slow and dangerous behind the wheel, can still serve a purpose, as we saw last night, as both Dwayne Wade and Andre Miller got their alley-oop on. Wade on the receiving end and Professor Miller on the giving end. Which was the better old man oop? D. Wade or Andre Miller? What you got?
Can I start this? It's sure. Andre Miller.
Why?
Because Andre Miller is older than me. He's 39. Dwayne Wade is 34. He's not even 34. He's 33. He's turning 34 soon. So for me to go with Wade would be saying I'm old. I don't think I'm old. I'm youthful at heart.
Yeah. Let's see what Lee's answer is, because I think Andre Miller's not quite
as old
as Lee. Hold on,
you're really creepy old.
Now, Andre Miller's a good age. He's a good vintage. But I'm actually going with Andre Miller because he threw that alley-oop before Zach LaVine even knew it was an alley-oop.
It's an amazing throw.
He throws it up there and Zach LaVine goes, oh, I better go and get this. Now, Zach LaVine can catch basically any ball that's in the air and throws it down nicely for him. I just think Andre from three-quarters court, that is an incredibly accurate pass. So for me, it's Miller.
We'll see you in Toronto in 5 weeks, Mr. Zach LaVine. But that's not an old man alley-oop if the young guy, I mean, how old is Zach LaVine? I don't think he's more than 22.
Yeah, he's like 21.
20, maybe. Yeah.
So it's not an old man alley-oop. It's Dwayne Wade. Because he did it with flair. He did it with old Dwayne
Wade. Was that intentional flair, though? Or was that just like
he kind of fell over?
No, look, that is old Wade.
That's accidental flair, Lee.
No, but that, during the entire game, and why I know this is purposeful flair, is because he got down on the floor, got to the rim, whenever he landed, and he was swagging out every single layup and dunk that he had. He was doing the old. He was feeling good.
Hey, hold on. You want to hear? See an old guy? Say swag, Lee.
Swag.
All right. What's the answer?
Was that a question?
Crazy kids.
The answer is Dwayne Wade. Definitely yeah. better because we used to be able to count on him for a huge dunk per year. So that's his dunk of the year.
He's not
excited
old.
Excited to have it back.
He's not old.
You're old. Lee, when's your birthday?
He's not old.
Mate.
All right. Andre Miller's older than you. Congratulations.
I didn't even know when his birthday is.
All right. When we come back, thumbs up or thumbs down when it comes to NBA All-Star Game voting. Reform. You're watching The Starters with a bunch of old guys. Welcome back to The Starters, right into the up-down report where the four of us figure out where we stand on some hot-button NBA topics. We ask you to do the same on Twitter, hashtag The Starters, thumbs up or thumbs down. All right, first one, guys. Last night in Utah, a Jazz fan was ejected for shining a laser pointer at James Harden's eye. Sorry, you can't not say laser.
A what pointer?
Laser. Harden was at the line. He pointed out to the fan to security. They found him. It was like, where's Waldo? But they found him. And he got banned. Not only ejected, banned for a year from NBA arenas. So,
Swift.
Yeah. Are you up or down on banning this Jazz fan a year for the laser pointer?
Yeah, I'm up.
Thumbs up.
I'm down.
Why?
Ban him for life.
For life?
What? Ban that jabroni for life. I don't often pull out the word.
For bringing a laser pointer to a game?
For flashing it on the court. It's incorrect. you don't do that. Okay, 5 years. One year is not
close your eyes. Just close your eyes, whatever you're doing.
What's going on here?
Well, the guy is here now.
What on earth? He's not banned from NBA shows. He's banned from NBA arenas. Yeah. He showed up.
I do applaud, though, the swiftness of security to find him, kick him out, and ban him straight away because it's silly. It is really silly. We went through a phase of this about 10 years ago.
Concerts, laser pointing?
Concerts and sure. sporting events. People started
That's
doing
true.
It. And if you don't get on top of this early...
Math class in grade three.
People will start doing it. My neighbor's cat, they used to drive him crazy.
Yeah.
But if you don't
cat.
Punish these people immediately, there will be a problem again because it's one of those things people go, oh, I'm going to do it myself. So, yeah, good. We all agree, really, in a way.
We're all thumbs up on that. All right, next one here, guys. Every year there seems to be at least one All-Star starter voted in by fans who has played just a few games or none at all. This year, that player could be Kyrie Irving, who at the time the first returns were announced had only played in two games. He was beating John Wall, Jimmy Butler, and others for the starting E spot. Our buddy Tom Ziller has an idea. Institute mandatory minimums for games played for eligibility into the All-Star game. So are you thumbs up or thumbs down on that sort of all-star game voting reform?
I think so. I think that's correct. I thought last year that Kevin Durant shouldn't get in when he had, this is just numbers here, but he had played in 45% of the Thunder's game. I'm not with Ziller in the 60% mark. Let's just make it 50. Got to play in half your team's games. I think that's a reasonable.
Yeah, but to me, this is an exhibition game for the fans.
You don't
the fans
care.
Are choosing who it is. If they want to see a guy who's played two games, but he's one of the most famous players in the league, and they really want to see him, then I think that that's fine because it doesn't really matter. This is an all-star game, and everybody's out there trying to have fun. Not to mention, if you're injured, might be nice to get a little run in.
It's a good point. It is hard to argue with that. The voting aspect is fans want to see who they want to see, and Kyrie is one of the most exciting players to watch. But I do think that there should be some sort of criteria to make it.
In terms of games played.
Yeah, and whether it's 40% or 60%, whatever it is, I think the NBA should just decide, okay, up until the day before of the All-Star game or the week before, if you haven't played in a certain amount, then maybe you should sit it out.
But don't we, I mean, we sort of do that when it comes to the coaches picking them. They're not going to pick, the coaches are not going to pick a guy that's played
in 10 games.
Yeah,
we're talking about the starters.
Yeah. This is the starters. It's the fans want to see. If it's Kobe hasn't played a single minute, if it's Yao Ming hadn't played a single minute, but enough fans want to get him in there and give him the accolades? I mean, who really cares, I guess?
Yeah. Well, the people who care are the players who are having a great season who may
get
ordinarily...
Because of it.
We saw it last year. We saw Damian Lillard extremely upset. We saw DeMarcus Cousins extremely upset when they were left off the ballot because players get voted in who aren't necessarily worthy, like in the Eastern Conference backcourt. Both those guys should not be starting, in Dwayne Wade and Kyrie Irving. Kyle Lowry should be starting in front of his hometown fans along with Jimmy Butler. But not to worry, I think Kyle Lowry will get the backing of the Biebs, Justin Bieber on Twitter.
Oh, the Bieber backing.
Hashtag NBA vote, he'll get him back in.
Who does Jimmy Butler get? Chance the Rapper or something?
Yeah, Chance the Rapper, maybe Kanye.
Oh, Kanye.
Get back into the Chicago game, who knows?
Maybe Isaiah Thomas will get him in, who knows?
Yeah, okay. All right, well, let's hear from you guys. This, again, we're going to be talking about this a lot, I think, as we lead up to the All-Star break. All right, final one here. Also last night, this is a funny one. In Brooklyn, tiny Celtics guard Isaiah Thomas, he just refused to even try during a jump ball against a much bigger man there in Thaddeus Young.
Everyone's much bigger, though.
For some reason, that's true. For some reason, this angered some small factions of the internet. Are you thumbs up or thumbs down on even not jumping for a jump ball?
Yeah, I don't like it.
The guy
what?
Is destroying the integrity of the game jump by not ball. Jumping. Just kidding, very funny, yeah. Definitely up on this.
Yeah, he knows, because we saw it early in the season, that you can't actually grab the ball if you're in the jump, but it's okay to go to a position and maybe tap it to one
yep,
of your teammates,
right.
So I think it's fine. He's not really doing anything that's totally against the rules. He's just trying to play it to his advantage, because pretty much every jump ball is against his advantage.
Well, you say it's pretty much against the rules. It definitely is against the rules. I'm down on it because he made me look up the rules. And the rules are,
sorry,
you can't leave the circle until the ball has been tipped.
Right.
And you can't touch it until one of the non-jumpers has also
okay,
touched
but
it.
I think that's what he's sort of thinking might happen.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, Thaddeus
you read it
goes
properly,
up.
But you can't leave. Usually he leaves, because Isaiah Thomas.
Yeah.
He's a serial leaver. He leaves and he's ready. He leaves before the ball is tipped.
All right. Well, let's hear from you guys. Are you up or down on a player not even jumping when you get to the jump ball? Let us know on Twitter. All right. Coming up, we're going back to Cali. We're not, but Kristen Ledlow will join us live from LA after the jump. You're watching The Starters.
Welcome back to The Starters. This is just the start of an action-packed night here on NBA TV. Starting right after us, the Auto Trader pregame show, which leads right into the fan night doubleheader. First game, Bucks-Bulls. That's a big rivalry game in the Kirby household. And then the Warriors and Lakers. And we are lucky enough to be joined by Kristen Ledlow from Los Angeles. Kristen, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
First, let's talk about the Warriors' injuries. I think Steph is fine. He played 32 minutes on Monday after dealing with the shin contusion for about three games. But Harrison Barnes is on a minutes restriction. What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, and 30 points for Steph, by the way, in that he seems to be doing
fine.
But limited minutes for Harrison Barnes still. We saw him play last night, as you said, and he received a standing ovation from Oracle Arena. Very excited to have him back. Of course, they were 17-0 when Harrison got hurt and had to take the bench. So he's back now, like I said, in limited minutes, but did score 8 points in his return, and they're looking to ease him back into that rotation tonight.
Okay, let's talk about Draymond Green, because he's ripping off these triple-doubles like the Warriors are ripping off wins. Three consecutive. What are you hearing about Draymond? Just the chatter going on about his triple-doubles.
Yeah, it's unreal what he's doing. Well, it's unreal what the Warriors are doing, period. But what Draymond is doing, especially having three straight triple-doubles, now he's looking for a fourth at the Staples Center, a fourth in a row. You know, he's already sitting right now where LeBron has set his entire career as far as triple-doubles go in a season at seven. So Draymond Green has been on an unbelievable tear. And I think that's exactly what you're trying to do if you're trying to get voted into perhaps a first NBA All-Star game right around this time.
Yeah, I think that's... Coming more and more like a lock, yeah. That Draymond Green is definitely going to get voted in at the very least by the coaches. Well, let's talk a little bit about the Lakers, though. It's sort of good news, bad news with the Lakers. The good news, they're on a three-game winning streak. That's great for them in this season. But the bad news is Coach Byron Scott is sort of feuding once again with forward Julius Randle, who's upset about the minutes he's getting and the substitution patterns. Byron Scott is quoted as saying Randle just needs to grow up. What are we hearing with the follow-up from that, which happened on Monday between Coach Scott, Randle, and I guess the Lakers in general?
Yeah, we saw Julius play less than 16 minutes against Phoenix, and he was noticeably upset and very frustrated by his limited minutes. Of course, Coach Byron Scott did say that he wants it bad, and sometimes this is what you see from that, but that he does need to learn to grow up, and that it's as simple as that. But yesterday in practice, Julius did at least show up, because Coach Scott said his attitude was just okay, and he said, yes, he did go through practice, but he's 21 years old, and this is part of growing up, and he said he'll get another shot at it tonight.
All right, thank you so much, Kristen. One request, can we get Steph Curry warming up, please? Maybe an Instagram video or photo?
I'm on it.
Yes,
great stuff.
Good to hear. All right, thanks so much, Kristen. Right after this, I'd like to think that this is the best solid play of the season so far.
It might be.
Was that it right there?
Nope.
Oh, good.
Stay
tuned.
Spoilers. You're watching The Starters.
Back with The Starters with your daily reminder that tomorrow I'll once again be doing the Pick'em Payoff. I lost the month of December, so I don't know. These guys got something in store for me. Is it?
Oh, we sure do.
Is it better or worse than snakes?
It's milkier than snakes.
Oh, tastier.
Oh, tastier. Great. Okay. Here's a look at last night's game, or pick. I took the Jazz, the only one. Everyone else took the Rockets. You guys were right. But I'm angry about this one, and I don't think my record should be 0-1.
Why's that?
Because if you saw the end of the game, the Jazz down two, they go to Jeff Withey for a dunk. He's going to dunk it. And he gets fouled by not one, two Rockets. No call.
But the fouls
I don't see
even.
It. I don't see it.
No call.
It. The fouls even each other out.
Come on. Come on, guys. All right, well.
Good, clean.
Tonight, I'm at least either going to win or lose with you guys. We all are taking the Mavericks at home to the Kings. Sadly, no Rondo in this one. I thought we were going to get a Rondo revenge game, maybe, but apparently he will not be playing. Lee, where are we going for a very solid play of the night?
Heading to Oakland, and it's another beauty from the Charlotte Hornets, the most improved very solid play team from last year. Spencer Hawes with a bounce pass through to Bit Roberts for the layup. Here it is.
Ooh.
Beautiful job. That's what I call a very solid play.
All right. Poor Brian Roberts is now only going to be called Bip Roberts.
Bippy. Got a lot of fan signs too, guys, that came in
over the break.
Yeah, we got a lot of them. First one comes in from Joe Wickfield and his pal in Cleveland there. Nice job, guys. Lots of color, lots of photos.
Hold on, is he wearing a wig?
I don't think so. Next one is from Dave Furnauer and his family in Phoenix. Also, a very, very good job there. The orange matches the Suns' court. Next one comes from Eric Svensson in Minnesota. Lots of good stuff on here as well. So many starterisms, I can't get through all of them. Another one comes actually
from... You know, like we always say, go Wolves.
From Moscow. This one comes from Moscow. Evgeny Gorbunov. Great job, Evgeny. Thank you very much for that. Another one comes from Devin Eli and his brother at a Clippers game.
Yeah.
Now, he should have been doing the kiss of death like Mario Eli. No, he didn't. Anyway, great job, guys. Another one comes
Mario
from...
Mario Eli? Who's that?
You know who I'm talking about. Sky Perry in Portland. Another one from Portland. The Blazers being well represented this year. He wants to challenge us to a game of one-on-one. The loser has to shave his head. Get the joke in there. Nice work. But the best sign we've probably had this year comes from this
guy. What a sign!
What a great job. He couldn't have put less effort in. But the face sells it. Look at that face. He knows it's a bad sign. He's done nothing to it, but it's still a kind of good one. So well done.
All right.
Well, he printed it at home.
And then he folded it up and put it in his back pocket. All right.
So bad it was great.
Keep the signs coming. We'll be back tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Eastern.
Thank you for joining us, folks. Enjoy the doubleheader. And remember, your tweet isn't a good one unless someone told you it sucked.
Embrace the night, people.